it's so obvious that for us here in Austria and Germany and so forth, working with privates, we sometimes look at the chains when it comes to certain things. We say, we don't have this. Maybe they look at us and say, why don't we have that? So this is the kind of discussion I would like to lead with a great panel, and I'm so grateful that you all agreed happily to join this. I may just start right over there. Aldina, that has already been on stage this morning. I don't have to introduce her anymore. I think so. It's the core group, and you're going to share some interesting things about this group that you are speaking for worldwide, responsible for the wellness upper scale segment and stuff like this. There's Neil Jacobs, who you all know also is from Six Senses and has a long history, professional history. Particularly also, now it's more in the wellness business, of course, but he has a very strong background in the hotel business. So he really knows also and has an in-depth knowledge, I would say, that you all want to hear about. There's Joseph Margreiter, who is or has been managing the director of Tirol Werbung, the Tirol Marketing Agency, for 20 years. And he will continue to do so, of course. 21 years, you told me today. So he's the man behind the brand Tirol. And he knows, since at least 20 years, to deal with, and he knows all the problems and little things that have to be solved with privately owned businesses. And then last but not least, we have Eva Maria from the Lanzerhof Group. She's managing director of the new and in the meantime, famous and award-winning resort in Tegernsee, Lanzerhof Tegernsee. And she's here instead of Christian Harisch, who had to stay in Hamburg. He couldn't fly here. He's sick. I don't know if it's good for your reputation if the managing director of a health resort is sick. But anyway, don't tell anyone. And he'll be soon, I think, doing better. I will just, to initiate, try to figure out the advantages of each other's concepts and models that we are facing. And I would really start with Aldina first, if you allow me, and have her say a little bit about her concrete position so we understand better the core group and what really this whole huge group is about, and in which way you would say the group, the fact that you are big, is an advantage for your business and also for the results that you can finally offer for the customers at the end of the day.
Okay.
Aldina.
First, Accor Hotel is a huge group, but we do not copy-paste our hotels. Each hotel project has a soul and has a story behind. And what I do, I design and I create wellness concepts for our hotels, more specifically for Sofitel, Pullman, and M Gallery. And then I go on site and I help the teams to develop those concepts on site, meaning that I adapt the concept and I adapt it locally. So this is exactly what I do. Okay. Then I create tools to help the teams over and over again to better perform, because when the concept is born, I mean, you need to better perform. And I guide as well the hotel team, the management team, on how to integrate this wellness concept as a guest enhancer, a guest experience enhancer.
Thank you. Neil, very glad to have you here.
Thank you.
Share a little bit about your great experience that you have.
Oh, you're way too kind. I'm very old, so I've got a lot of experience. Right? I ran Asia for Four Seasons for many years, and also looked after spa and wellness globally for Four Seasons. And then 4 years ago, I was lucky enough to be part of a group that purchased Six Senses, which we now own 100%, and we're based out of Thailand. We have about 12 hotels today, many, many under development, and probably by the end of next year, we will have 35 or so spas and wellness centers around the world. Really, wellness is, you know, I think we fit somewhere in between, you know, the world of destination spas and the world of great hotels with good hotel spas. We're kind of in the middle of that. But certainly wellness is a huge driver of everything we do and every project we look at before we go further with it. We're all very mindful of how we can drive a wellness agenda through that property in one form or another, very contextual, and something that would fit a lot of the programming that we've put together over the last few years.
Okay, thank you. Advantages of change. A few bullet points, Neil.
Well, I consider Accor a great chain, you know, and I'm not sure. I think we are a chain because we have multiple hotels, but I mean we're not a large organization, and I think we fit somewhere in the middle of say an Accor or a Lanzerhof. You know, we have the advantage of being able to afford good marketing. You know, we do have a global network of marketing and people on the ground selling and PR agencies around the world, which not every independent can really afford to do. So I think that's certainly an advantage for us and for the larger chains. I think our size versus, say, a larger group like Accor allows us to be more nimble than the larger groups. The decision-making process is faster, perhaps not as nimble as a family-owned property where you can sit around at dinner and make decisions, but certainly for a group our size, we're able to do that pretty rapidly and get our agenda listened to. So I think for a company our size, those two elements are really good advantages.
Okay, great, thank you. Joe, you are the one that knows individually owned businesses with a strong wellness context here in Tirol. What would you consider the advantages mainly for these small structured and individually owned hotels here? Speaking about basically many, 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 many hotels all over Europe. We're not just talking about Tirol or Austria, because that's the business model here, at least in Central Europe.
Well, I hope this model that we have here also is telling us a lot about, as you say, family-run hotel businesses in general. I have an easy life now because Stanglwirt has just been on stage, Balthasar Hauser, with his family story. I grew up on the farmhouse. My parents turned this farm business, which was no business, was too small, into a hotel business. So from Landwirt to Gastwirt, from the farmer to the hotelier is our story in the country. And to answer your question, first of all, we are happy that over all the decades, what people are searching here in our little alpine worlds is a very individual and very personal hospitality. So you always travel not to the house or the resort, you travel to the person. So you stay at Cygnus Hotel or at France Resort and you want to meet them, so the nest has to be warm. If you go to Stanglwirt, there's always somebody of the family taking care of you, 365 days. So that's one of the top advantages. You have to deliver it. You have to have the energy for that. I always say it's a soul energy, not only just physical energy, that you have to somehow have to in your chance. I don't know. You cannot learn that, to really look after your guests so personally. So that's one very strong point that also I think carries us into a good future. On the other hand, you asked me for advantages only because I could tell you a long list of disadvantages in the family.
We're getting there, don't worry.
Very, very hard work.
We're getting there.
We go back. A second advantage, perhaps I shall throw 2 points which are surprising you. Size does not matter. We're always talking about economies of scale when we talk about chain hotelery and groups in between, as you said. And we, until short time ago, we also believed if you have only 50 beds, only 70 rooms, it's not enough economies of scale for marketing, for all your kind of insourcing things. You are just buying too expensive and you will never make a profit with your house. So it's all your hard work that has to cover it all and balance it all. So if you count the family hours working in there and whatever else comes it, then it's not a business anymore. And we have now proofs that not only on one side, that's my second point, the strongest hotels in Austria, number one in revenues, guess who it is? It is Sacher Hotel with the famous chocolate cake in Vienna. By the way, running also a beautiful wellness resort hotel in here in Tirol.
5-star.
Yeah. Astoria. And is this number one? Number two is Hilton in Vienna, so it's two city hotels. And number three is Stanglwirt. And in the top 20, another 10 is family-managed best wellness resort hotels, as I may call them, like Stanglwirt, Schwarz, Post Hotel, and so on. All between 10 and 20 million any annual revenue. Stanglwirt, by the way, is 35 million annual revenue. This family farmhouse hotel business. So it's great. So
that was a secret, by the way. That was a secret, the 35 million.
You didn't know it.
As you said, it was. It was.
Told everyone their revenue.
So we see also in the figures of smaller hotels, like with 50 rooms or so, that they also can make very, very good profits. So size doesn't matter. And as you heard now, you will be impressed how big and competitive these family businesses can be. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of advantage. And how did they do it? Elisabeth was sitting there from Stanglwirt. He hasn't got the time to find all the education. He had to teach himself to practice and learn fast, which he did. And he was always, as he said, I needed more ideas and more passionate work because I didn't get the money from whatever investor or bank. So I had to do it myself. But the second generation, and in many of these places you see, they sent them to the chain hotels, to the chain and big hotel world to learn the systems. In Stanglwirt, you have a perfect controlling system today, like in Hilton. It's as good. All quality control systems, everything is now in place in the second and third generation. So that's another point. Use your personal touch that is part of a unique part of your product, and then develop whatever is to develop with the best to have a most professional system. Staff training, control, mm-hmm. quality control, and. So that's the mixture, actually, is the future.
Okay, thank you. So, Eva Maria, you also are representing a very successful business model. You're probably not singing for your guests as Balthasar Hauser does, but you make people healthier. And so you are on a really strong economic basis here, a very successful business model. For health resort here in the area, but beyond also because you made that rollout and you are growing now. But what would you, as my first question to you, consider the advantages of being big enough to make professional services, but small enough to make really quick decisions? What would you consider the advantages of you being a standalone, so to speak?
Well, I think it's more or less exactly what Joseph said right beforehand. It's a mixture of both components. First of all, at Lanzerhof, we have the advantage to be very flexible to make our decisions. But also, it's very important for us to be very individual for every customer, for every client. Dr. Benedetto was first here on the stage. And for us, it's most important that every customer, every guest feels like at home. I know you've heard that sentence quite often today, but it's really, in my opinion, the most important thing for a spa hotel today. And also the Hauser family, we've seen just before, they have a very own way to, I don't know, to give a little bit more to the guest. They sing, they do, they want to create a vision of hospitality. And for us at Lanzerhof, by the way, we are also a family-run group, and actually we are not as large. We have three Lanzerhof at the moment. The owner is Dr. Harisch, who unfortunately couldn't make it today. I'm part of the family, and for us the best thing is to make people happier, and we really have a very strong vision behind our concept. And I think that that's a very big advantage, that in a very small group like Lanzerhof, for example, we have the time to follow that vision constantly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. So we have a first impression now. I think it's getting to a little bit too harmonious here on this
yeah,
panel. I really want to ask you a question. You know, you said we have these privately owned businesses, we have people singing for us, you know, everything like 365, everybody's here all day long. Why wouldn't I feel just as well and as at home or as my second home in one of your gorgeous Sofitels somewhere along the coastline or in your Six Senses places? Why wouldn't I feel myself as well?
Well, I think we all talk about...
Is it really just about meeting the owner? What's the difference?
No, I don't. I think we all talk about hospitality, and you know, in the hotel business, we all talk about the same thing. I think, though, that, you know, a Lanzerhof-type thing wins because of its pure... I mean, wins, gets business, everything else, because of the purity of its intention. You know, I think part of the challenge with the larger hotel groups and is that the coming from is not always the right coming from the right place. And this is not to kind of question your intention or your personal intention, mm-hmm. but when you're sitting in the boardroom of, you know, a Starwood or a Marriott, which is one today, or an Accor, which is of that size, you know, the kind of revenues that the spa component of the overall business is bringing to the table is insignificant in the scheme of the business that they are in. You know, at most, it's, what is it? It's 10% of the business at most,
no.
You know, with a relatively high cost to it. So the flow through the bottom line it doesn't mean anything because it's a really small part of the business. You're there doing your thing. How many people are there in the spa world at Accor?
So at the corporate level, we are two people.
We have. And how many hotels do you have?
So we have 300 hotels and 150 spas and fitnesses. So what we do, because we have 300 since 2 years, because we went through a reorganization 2 years ago. So before, we were only with Sofitel. Sofitel was a business unit. Mm-hmm. So, for example, when we launched SoSpa concept back in 2009, we went to one concept, to one hotel, to now we have 41. And I can guarantee you that the 41 SoSpas are exactly following the rules. And
so well, they're all the same?
No, they're not all the same. They have the same spirit, the same philosophy. Oh. But then they adapt to the local culture. Because mm-hmm. we export the French beauty. We export the Frenchness of spa, this philosophy of beauty and art de vivre, as we say, and we adapt it, we blend it to every local culture. So we blend it in Vietnam, we blend it in Los Angeles, we blend it in Munich, we do it everywhere. That's what we do. And we are not a lot of people, but because we have very clear concepts and very clear guidelines, and I do not only work with the spa team, I work with the hotel management. And it's part of the bonus if they apply the strategy or not. So this makes a huge difference.
You know,
let's
I mean, you have to say that.
And
right?
plus, well, let me say one advantage with the working with chains, because you know we have in our network.
People. You're two people for 300 spas.
No, 150.
Oh, sorry. that's a lot better.
That's a lot better. Half of it. You cut the cake in half. What was I saying?
You know,
but now we're more. We're more now.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
We're more because we have Andrew coming up.
I don't know. You know, when I was at Four Seasons, we had 80 spas. I looked after them as my night job, because I was running Asia Pacific for Four Seasons. And to this day, with close to 100 spas, and I love that company, you know, they're my family, and they would love, but they still don't believe that it's worth the investment of putting one full-time person in a corporate office to drive a spa agenda. So to me, that kind of says it all, really. You know, I mean the commitment often with the large companies is kind of, that's why I talk about the coming from, you know. Yeah. It's just not always there, because it's about the money. It's just about the money.
Absolutely, but it's also about the customer, and the customer has a different view, of course. You know, the chains obviously have to see the money, they have to see the revenue, and have to see the outcome. Otherwise, they wouldn't invest or wouldn't grow. I want to change, you know, the view to the customer side, because I think that is probably the more interesting one. Is the product, particularly thinking about wellness hotels now, and not just hotels like Hilton's or stuff, is the product that a chain can offer, as you said, as a night job, you will probably be handling the strategic questions of 50 or 60 five-star spas, which to me, honestly, is ridiculous. You know, I mean, can you live up to these new needs and desires and demands of the grown-up wellness customer as a standardized hotel group? Aldina, I'm asking you. You have the big group.
Well, you know, we just reviewed our strategy completely, and we are very guest-centric, very guest-focused. And the thing is to, how do we infuse wellness in our hotels? And we just came up with this very simple idea, actually. And I just worked this out for 2 years, and now it's being implemented. As we speak now, it's on. So we're just focusing on four pillars, which are sleep, food, sport, and spa. It's very easy to understand, and I say that because when you have to convince a general manager that he needs to focus on sleep as part of the wellness pillar, on food as part of the wellness pillar, and so on with sport and spa, he looks at me and says, are you sure we're going to do this? Yeah, you have beds, so let's walk the extra mile and let's, you know, think this as a overall guest experience. Because when the guest checks in into a hotel, you know, we never connect all the dots together. Maybe not with your company, but in our company, because with such huge hotel chain, we just take care about the check-in, and we have services to offer to the guest during his stay so that he can feel comfortable. But we never connect the dots together. So what we did with these four pillars, it's an opportunity for the guest and for the employees as well to just offer this, I say in French, the palette de service, all these services when the guest comes in, so he knows immediately what the hotel has to offer during the stay. And it's picking up. So now we are about to transform this guest experience.
Eva Maria, how does that sound for you if you listen to Aldina? Would you think that your offers, which are no doubt world-class, would be any worse or any better if you would have 5 or 10 more resorts somewhere worldwide?
Well, I think it's a different approach. Mm-hmm. I completely agree with you. But for us at Lanzerhof, we really benefit from the fact a customer is coming to our hotel and the same person as last time is saying, hello, hello again, good to see you back. And there's the feeling, and that's what we try to create. I think it's a different product. We are a very niche product at Lanzerhof, and it's all about attention. Our guests, they want attention and they want authenticity. They really want a real product, and they want the employees not to be friendly, standardized. Good afternoon, how are you today? They really want that the employee cares for the guest. And for us, we have a meeting every day with all the employees. Our main goal is to make every client as happy as possible. And we know that, I think it's a different approach when you are a hotel chain. We are a small hotel. We know every guest. You tell me one name, I know the face normally. Not for every guest, but well, I think this would never work for a large hotel chain, but this is the special thing what people are looking for when they come to a Lanzerhof. And also we have a very extraordinary product. They also, our guests, they want the same people where they've already gained trust. They don't want the new masseur or a therapist. They want the therapist from last time who made their disease fine again.
Well, that's pretty interesting, I think, that you stress this. You know, you said that you want to make the customer happy. I would suppose every representative of any hotel, chain or non-chain, would have that same claim.
Of course.
Think the question we have to face here is who could do it better?
I think a smaller hotel group is more better able to provide this service, as you are able to know the clients better.
You know, I worked for an independent hotel before for 4 years, Hotel Bristol in Paris, and of course there are different attentions to guests because you have more means. I mean, you have more people. First of all, so the ratio staff per guest is like multiplied by 3 or 4. So it's huge. It's a palace hotel. But I can tell you that every single property has an hotel management and a GM that is alive. The GM is not a ghost. So the GM, even in an hotel chain, is there, and his job is to go and greet personally the guests. I mean, not all of them, of course, because when you run at 300 hotel rooms, you cannot go there in the morning and greet everyone. But definitely, we have in our hotels 60% return guests, so these guests, we recognize them, even if they don't stay like 1 week, if they're not there for a cure, even if they stay for one night because they have one big meeting. Our job is to make sure that this special guest is comfortable and for this one single night.
But you're not talking about wellness. You know, the challenge is 8 out of 10 general managers are really not equipped to do what you do in your hotel, and to a certain extent what we do in our hotels. That's not why they're hired. It's not part of the recruitment process. They didn't grow up. They didn't go to Professor Tabaki's classes at Cornell and Spa. They should do. They should have done, But so the challenge the large companies have, not just yourself, corporately, companies that have a real spa and wellness agenda, is to get that buy-in. And, I used to, at Four Seasons, would say to my GMs, when was the last time you used the spa? You know, and many would say, well, actually, I don't think I've ever had a treatment there. And, it's like, well, do you go to your restaurant? Oh, yeah, I do that all the time. So why wouldn't you go to your spa? Because the thinking is just not there. And
it doesn't come from the top down when it's a conversation about the type of GMs that you're going to recruit. So you may get the service and you may get the repeat guest kind of interaction, but the buy-in to a spa and wellness agenda in most larger hotel companies who do not have a wellness as a real part of their DNA,
absolutely.
It's not
right.
there. It's just not there. Okay. I mean, we struggle with some. We've got 12, 13 hotels and times struggle with implementing programming with GMs. Go, what, you know, what do you want to do? And, you know, it's just not part of what they do.
Joe, how does that sound for you?
You asked us to look at the guest's point of view. And before right. I do this, just one more remark. On the business side, if I am well informed, then the business model of the chains has other variations. The first business they do is, and mostly separated is in their own company, is the real estate business. So chains have a big real estate business, mainly in the cities, which we in the family enterprises hardly have here. So this is an income stream. A return on investment that we cannot count on, you know. So you don't build Lanzerhof to sell it in 10 years, you know, or to whatever make the value grow of the building. This is you have to do your earnings with the operational business. If I look at the operations of the chains, then they. First of all, they have started insourcing. Very often, you didn't know, is this fitness center at the whatever Hilton Intercontinental, is it part of their own operation or is it an insourced one? Mm-hmm. So you just insourced into your building. Again, real estate business. You had some rental fee here. Now you start, then you understand and say, okay, no, this is a good business. We should do it on our own. And that's where you're going now. Mm-hmm. And there is room for both from the client's point of view mm-hmm. now, because you have a fast moving guest, you know, one night or two, a conference here, a business there. I need a fitness center. I need a massage, a haircut, whatever, beauty treatment, everything is there. Perfect. Mm. I don't need a Balthasar Hauser to sing a song for me there. I have not time for that. You know, but when I do really want to do it, as the word says, a holiday to really heal myself, yeah, then I don't go to your place. Except that for more than 10 years, there would be the same wonderful lady doing the wellness treatments for me, running the center. Except the hotel director, we have such chain hotels also in Austria, is there for 30 years already. So it's like an owner. It's the soul in the house. If you have that, then that could be the exception. But in general, I don't believe in that. Yeah. And back to the consumer, the more, as we learn here, he learns about the holistic approach to his health, the prevention and everything, that it's a lifelong program there, he needs a home for that. He needs a home for that. And that's where the family has its place. If it's a grown-up family, you don't have to be the same father and mother. Family feeling, you said, at Lanzerhof.
Okay.
The same people for many, many years creating this family mm-hmm. spirit working together. The challenge on our side is if there is no real estate business, you can throw yourself like medical wellness at Lanzerhof on the high end of the market and make your business there. But you said, Franz, we have 400 wellness hotels in Tirol. But I would say hardly half of them make the benefits or at least in percentages that I mentioned earlier, hardly half. They are struggling, fighting, working hard to write. And one thing is, how can they, as the second generation of these successful hotels shows, how can they learn from the best systems, mostly created by chains, by groups, and so on, and implement that quickly to have their economy of scale? If it's 50
Very
rooms
good point.
Or if it's 200.
Very good point.
That's the big challenge. The education approach is actually the big challenge for the family enterprises.
Okay. Thank you so much. I think this is the best point now because we do have two contributors that are helping us in our discussion. And I think this is the perfect time now to introduce to you one hotelier from Poland, which is one of these big emerging markets right now. Their hotel is in the very north of Poland, at the Baltic coast. Agnieszka Trafas, she's here with us today. And she said she's really a representative of one 100% family-owned business that started right after the opening of the East Block, or the end of the East Block. And they were struggling, of course. You know, they're very successful now, they're growing, but it was really like from zero that they started. And Agnieszka said she was kind enough to share a little bit of her experience. Maybe you could be so kind and stand up if you do have a micro, otherwise I'm getting it for you. Thank you.
As you know, Poland is a free country from, a really free country from 1989. So my parents created a company in 1989, and it was a construction company. And on the beginning of 2000, they decided to do the second leg, so to create a second business, and we decided to open a cure hotel because our city is famous for mud treatments and mineral water treatments. We are on the Baltic coast. And we began with a copy of other public hotels which are located in our city, but a little bit better copy, a private one with an own swimming pool and own medical division. And on the beginning, it was for me, I didn't have any experience in the hospitality, so it was for me a very good decision to watch how the chain hotels are working. So how is the system, how is the structure, how are the divisions of a hotel, so food and beverage, reception, housekeeping. It was a new knowledge for me. And I think we did it pretty well. So because we are now budgeting, we are planning in a very long term. So we are like a very well organized company. We are training our people. And I think we took all of them from the chain companies. And with the time, with my travels, also in a business way, but also in a private way, mm-hmm. I felt in love in smaller hotels. So I really like this charming atmosphere you can find in Tirol.
Agnieszka, if I may just ask here. So basically what you're saying is part of your success story is that you, at a certain phase of your development, decided to learn from hotel groups.
Yes.
And that made you better. And now you said you have... What kind of things did you learn from the groups, by the way? Just a few bullet points. Is it financing? Is it structuring?
I would
standardization?
The structure of the hotel, the processes, how that you have to watch the guests, how they flow through your hotel. So we bought a software to work at the reception in other divisions. We know how to learn. How to train our people, so human and resources.
Operational things that you learned, is that what you're saying?
Sorry?
Operational things?
Yes. I would say we got the basics from the chain hotels, but then we developed our own way to work with the guests. We developed our own spirit, and we found our own way how to develop the business because... It was boring to do the cure business all the time. We want to develop, and then we decided to go to the lifestyle hotel. So we want to influence our guests to change their lifestyle, to change the habits of food and living. And
Agnieszka, if I may ask here also, you said... your offering is basically a health and a wellness offer. Mm-hmm. Would that go rather with a standardized bigger group? Or do you think being individual, being that one standalone hotel in the north of Poland, is part of your success story for the next couple of years? Is that what you're saying?
I don't know what will come because, as you know, I will begin in 1 month the renovation, reconstruction of the hotel, modernization. And I have a very, very ambitious team, so maybe we will develop to a group of hotel. I don't know. I have an appetite for it, but as we all said, I want to have a balance in my life, so we will see okay. in the next years how it will be developed.
Thank you. Thanks so much. And we have another contributor that fits perfectly in this discussion right now. It's Michael Altivischer. He's a managing director since many years for a cooperation of wellness hotels, and that's 50 hotels. It's called Wellness Hotels and Resorts. He's right over here if you want to give him a mic. Because one thing I would like to know from Michael is knowing these corporations. We have similar ones in Northern Italy, Tirol, of course. They work together, as any corporation, obviously, but they try to adapt as many structures from the chains as necessary to do well in terms of buying, marketing, finances, transcouting, what have you. But on the other hand, for the customer, they try to hide that somehow. So they try to be that individual place here and there, but at the end, underneath the surface, they work more or less in some way like a chain. Michael, what are your experiences?
What is the question? No, I can share all my experiences with Joe. In our collaboration, we made the decision to give every hotelier his individual Italy. Because when we going up to say, like Accor, it's just one rule and everybody in every hotelier have to do the things we think that you have to do in Düsseldorf, it wouldn't work. They are all little diamonds, and every diamond has its own light. So we want, as a collaboration, give them an idea what makes wellness run in your hotel, and give the customers an idea, just choose the hotel, which is the one for you. If it's at the sea, take it as a sea. And the next time you want to go to the Alps, go to the Alps. And then it's your decision as a customer. Do I want to live in a big house like Neptune on the Baltic Sea, 350 rooms, and not privately run? Or you want to go to Husum at the Northern Sea with 23 rooms and being part of the family? And that's the differences. And I think if it's possible to get the best of both worlds. The thing to say, okay, what's happened around the world, that's the reason why I'm here, and give the idea what's happening around the world in rather 4 weeks at the collaboration meeting to the chefs who are in front of me, and they are able to ask and say, okay, you have been there 3 days, give me an idea in between half an hour. What do we have to expect from the wellness sector in between the next 4 years? It's perfect for them. And if they need specialists, I do have the name, let's say, from you, and give them the connect and say, if you want to know further things, just call him. And if not, wait 2 years, wait 3 years, and if then there's a question, they could ask me, who has it been? And I give them the idea, he's the one. So maybe it's good for many of the hoteliers. Of course, some diamonds shine brighter and they won't be a solitaire. Mm-hmm. Let them be a solitaire.
Okay. Thanks, Michael. I think many in this room have a similar notion now that there could be something, and that's my question, looking on the watch, it's going to be the last question already, I'm sorry to say. Will there be something like a hybrid between the individual hotel and the classical chain that is known as standardized and, you know, copied a million times? Again, from the point of view of the customer, does the new, the educated wellness guest ask for more individuality? So I'm observing, for example, in chains like yours, the more upscale you are offering, the more you stress the fact that it's individualized, which is unusual for years from people from the privately owned hotel business. So I see, if I may say, and I think many in that room do also, a step from some of the chains towards this individual, which is, I would say, something like a USP of the privately owned business. And on the other hand, as we just heard, others try to organize themselves under the surface that the customer doesn't even know or even see in a way that chains are strong in, like marketing, financing, and so forth. Can we expect, and that's my last question to the round now, can we expect in the next couple of years, particularly when it comes to wellness offerings, something like a hybrid?
I think that Six Senses is a hybrid, because it kind of just fits.
So we have it already.
It fits in. Well, it's an interesting question, because I also, we are a hybrid because we have some of the elements that exist within a chain relative to marketing, PR, training systems, and yet we're small enough to be very individual. And the difference is, it's the number one piece of our DNA. So we would not do a hotel or a resort or whatever, however good it could be, without a huge element of wellness. And not every developer wants to do that. So we come at it from the starting point of wellness and sustainability. Mm-hmm. All right, that's the difference. I don't think you will see many more like that. I think the barrier to entry is too high. I think you may see more destination properties such as Lanzerhof, and you'll see more hotel spas. But that hybrid, you know, when I look at our competitive set, that is five or six companies mm-hmm. out there, mm-hmm. you know, none of them really care about the wellness piece the way we do at Six Senses. So from the point of view of wellness, I don't think you're going to see a lot, but okay. there is hybrid. In defense, and I would just like to say this, in defense of the Accors of the world, you know. Hey.
All thank right. you, all Neil. Right. Oh, thank you.
Finally, she gets support.
Finally.
If you look at where we were as an industry, you know, 15 years ago, compared to where we are today, you know, a great deal of that success and awareness and customer awareness and customer demand and want comes from what the large chains have done. Mm-hmm. Because we've come a long way when hotels had a gym and, you know, one treatment room next door to where we are today. And even if the larger chains don't have these really, really intense wellness programs the way that, yeah. that you do, you know, what they've done for the reputation of the industry and the awareness and the knowledge and education of the user is absolutely huge. So I think that's a significant role that the Accors and other companies like them have played over the last 10 years or 15 years. I mean, that's significant.
Very
so
interesting.
Well done.
So, Neil spoke about Accors. Aldina, what about Six Senses?
Yeah. I have to go now.
Well, I think it's a perfect hybrid model, actually.
So it's like a role model, even, you would say, something that we can expect.
You know, it's
how far away.
I mean, they sell destination spa. Actually, the guest goes there, he knows what to expect. He goes there just to get to on a wellness retreat almost. You know, it's this is my vision, this is what I think. So it might not be the reality, but it's what I have in mind when I think about Six Senses properties. Mm-hmm. So it's like a destination spa. That we can have with Accors too. We have like 20 destination spas in our network where the guests go there to get the treatment, but of course it's not the majority of our network. So.
Okay. Now, finally, Lanterhof, before we come to Joe to close up.
When will you Lanterhof? Have 150 Lanterhofs?
Well, is that the goal? I think that would never happen.
There's a strong brand question behind this, I think, which needs to be discussed also.
Yeah, that's a very good question. Well, I think also we are learning from the hotel chains in the back. We have standardized processes everywhere. But anyhow, I don't think there will be many hybrids. Mm. And I think it's very difficult for a point of view as Lanterhof, because we are in a very luxury segment and we are quite a niche. And for us, most important is attention. And I don't think that it's very easy to create it when you expand very rapidly. Because also we have seen it, we've grown quite fast in the recent years. And it's always very important that the soul and the vision stays. That our concept was grown in Lanz 30 years. This took a long time. And I think it's very difficult to expand the vision just like that. I think it has to grow with people. And this might sound a little esoteric, but that's my reason for our success behind Lanzerhof.
All right, very interesting. Joe?
First of all, it was a brilliant question. I don't know if we want to hear what you hear now, but the answer is it depends to the promise that you give to your guest. If you promise individualism, personal treatment services, you can't be too many. If you sell the nice cut or pullover at every city, an individual person will not shop there. It will go to an individual shop, which is just one and only or few. That's a pretty, otherwise it's a contradiction to be individual as the world trends go for more individualization and so on. But I have no fear that there is room for all, you know, because talking about the word hybrid, we have learned it from the automotive industry, right? Mm-hmm. If you have to decide today between the best, newest BMW, Mercedes, whatever, diesel, it can't be Volkswagen at the moment, but the others, good ones, or a Toyota hybrid, I think they were the big leader in hybrid cars, or a Tesla, what would you choose? It's your taste. Toyota is extremely successful, especially with hybrids, and so on. And Tesla will, be a leading intelligence car company of the future. So there is room for all. But if I would have to decide myself, I would say, looking at this car history, a hybrid is always only an in-between solution. It's not a proper solution. That's what I think. You have to. That's one point. And the other point is, we are going into a sharing economy. We are all collaboration, cooperation, networking makes the future. I think there is no doubt about that.
But Joe,
so in a way, we have to build in our family-owned, private-run hotels where there is the passion, where there is the soul, where you can promise and deliver individuality, personality. We have to implement all these professional systems for buying whatever you need in your place, for staff education, control, quality control, and so forth, to use the economies of scale that you need and that you only can perhaps find in a network and not on your own in a small place. So that's, I think that's, if you call that a hybrid, then okay, then I would say yes, but this is not a hybrid for me. This is just a new way of of managing your private business in a network and sharing community. And on the other side, and that's perhaps a last point that I want to make for discussing it in the evening, if we thank you very much, merci beaucoup pour la formation de vos équipes, de vos systèmes. If we have the benefit of sending our family members to the greatest systems like Accor to learn from the best how to build these economy of scale systems behind our little private businesses, let's ask ourselves, where is the education system for the next generations of leaders that we need in all our enterprises. Is it only at Accor? Is it at our hotel and tourism management schools? Are they up to date to deliver these people? Mm-hmm. So what is there the solution? Because my point tonight here is key is the education. So we have to have the intelligence to really build this professionalism into our family-run business. The heart and the ideas of our young generations is plenty. Mm-hmm. They are so individual. They are full of ideas. They have to learn to manage it well. This is the weakest point in our Alpine hotel business, the management quality. If it's there, it goes like a rocket.
Which again is a core competence of the groups. So, you know, I see that it is like a both parts, if I may say, going in the right direction. You know, they really are seeing the advantages of the other side, and they are really adopting it here and there. And we will see what the next couple of years will bring in this direction. Thank you, panel, so much for openly sharing all your expertise and insights. Thank you for listening. Give a round of applause to the audience. Thank you.